give you an amen? Well, I'll be ready for anything, you bulldog.
Welcome to Cool Water. Whether you are here or joining us online, it is great to have you here with us on this third Sunday now of Advent. And so we join in worship this morning. We are delighted this morning to welcome Dwight Brewer, a very familiar face to Cool Water, who is extraordinary in his musical talents. And we are glad to have you. Dale is up in Montana now seeing his father. And so we wish Dale well and all their family. We lift them up in our prayers. Dwight and the Dynamite Band, consisting of Jen and Dave today, we're glad you're here. And if you will lead us in our music, and let's stand and sing.
Sing, heaven, heaven, nature, sing. To the world, the Savior reigns. Let all their songs employ fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains. Repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat. Sounding joy. Heaven's sorrows grow, no thorns infest the ground, comes to make his blessings known. Far the curse is found, far the curse is found, far as the curse is found. Thank you.
Gracious God, we lift our hearts in love and praise. In this season of Advent, keep our minds and our hearts on the reason that we are here. Jesus the Christ, our Lord, his entry into the world, may he always be our light and our salvation. And it's in his name that we lift up our worship this day. Amen. Take a moment and greet the people here this morning, as is our Cool Water tradition. Good morning. Let's continue with our worship. Let me remind people of the leadership meeting that is right after worship today. And we lift congratulations to Tatiana Rohani. She celebrated a birthday this last Wednesday, December 7th, and it happened to be her 15th birthday. And in Hispanic cultures, it is an age where a child goes in to become a young woman, a quinceañera. And there was a quinceañera celebration yesterday at their house, and congratulations to Tatiana and Ileana and Mansoor. The festiveness was wonderful. It was a terrific celebration. And Ileana said, I don't think that I will be in church tomorrow. And I said, you have an official excuse. So they are recovering from the celebration, but we lift up Tatiana in that very significant moment of her life. Next weekend is our drive-through nativity. Saturday night, Sunday night, the times when people will be coming are 6 to 8. Now, some elves have been extremely busy and creative. And they have created, well, a sizable stack of cards. So take cards, pass them out to your friends, your neighbors, people you don't know. Okay? So they are here. And, you know, I'm going to do like we used to do in school, well, like I do, and here, take one or take a few and pass them along. I'll take care of this side myself. Well, these are going to the same household, so you can always have more. All right. We lift up in our prayers. Oh, well, before we get to that, reminder of the schedule for Christmas weekend. On the 24th, we will be having our service at 7:30, not 7 o'clock, because of the Life Recovery Church, and they want to have a Christmas Eve service. So we are pushing ours back from the 7 o'clock time to the 7:30 time. And then Christmas morning, I know I will be here. 10 o'clock worship as scheduled, and I would love to see some bright, shining faces. So we will be here on Christmas Sunday. Are there any announcements or cares, concerns, celebrations to lift up? Oh, your aunt, and where is she? In Maryland. Wow. So 97 years old, Karen's aunt. So we hold you and all your family close. I know it's difficult. In the same kind of context, we lift Dale and his family up. Dale is up there with his father, who is now in hospice care. There's no time frame, but they don't want to go to extraordinary measures. He's 96, and they just want him to have quality of life. So we lift up Dale and all of his family. All right, then let us go to our Lord in prayer. It's one of the privileges we have as Christian people. Before I lead you, take moments for silent prayers of your own. Holy God, in this season of waiting and anticipation, we lift to you the dreams and yearnings of our hearts. This is a season of hope and new beginnings. Fill us, we pray, with a renewed commitment to following your way, to work to bring the kingdom and its light and love and joy and peace to those lives we are able to touch. In the midst of all the frenzied holiday preparations, slow us down. Prepare in our hearts a warm and welcoming place that we might receive the gift of your Son. Create in us a quiet place where these holidays can truly be holy days. As we think of giving gifts to others, we ask you, O God, for gifts that only you can give. To those who are sick and facing an uncertain future, give the gift of a vision of healing and wholeness, that in your desire for all creation, and you are the light for salvation, for hope, for peace. To those who are mourning and face the holidays with mixed emotions, give the gift of a deepened awareness of your presence with them and of the hope that you give. To those who are lonely, sorrowing, or anxious, give the gift of your power, peace, and patient endurance through these difficult times. To those who are out of work, without a home, and all those who struggle with the reality of living day to day, give the gift of hope that doors will be opened in their future. each one of us, we pray that we might see afresh the love and wonder that is born into the world at each and every moment. May each of us welcome your Son, the Son before whom even the desert blooms and rejoices. Help us to welcome Christ our Lord in this Advent season as we prepare for Christmas. Help us to welcome him with an open heart and a receptive spirit so that he might touch our lives where we have need, even in ways we do not realize. For you send your gift, not with ribbons and fancy wrapping, but with simplicity and humility. And we give thanks for all your gifts of life, and especially the gift of life in Jesus Christ our Lord. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Let me call forward the LeDuc family, and they are lighting our third Advent candle this morning.
Hello? It's on now. We want everything to look nice. The decorations of the season, our homes with their lights and tinsel, wreaths and ribbons. We want to lighten the darkness around us, bring beauty to the ugliness that wears us down. We decorate because it's tradition, because it lifts our hearts, because it makes us feel like children again. We deck our halls because company is coming.
The prophet Isaiah smiled when he said, God will give a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness inside of mourning, the mantle of praise inside of faint spirit. No matter how far we feel from the spirit of the season, God promises to decorate us with love and with joy.
We light these candles as a sign of our joy in the beautiful things of this season, not just the things that glitter and flash, but the deeper things, the beauty of the heart and the soul, the beauty of love shared in service and hospitality. We light this candle of joy because company is coming. O come, Emmanuel.
Please pray with me. Dear God, we carry many burdens and worry over many things. Help us to hear your promise in this Advent season, that in hearing we may receive the Spirit's gift of joy, and may our spirits be kept sound at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know? That your baby boy is Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? That the sleeping child you're holding is the
Today's scripture is from the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 46 to 56. These verses are known as the Magnificat, Mary's Song of Praise. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but he has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and to his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. The word of God for the people of God.
I don't know why I bring the folder up and undo it, so I never look at it. I guess it's just a comfort to know that if my mind suddenly leaves me, I can come here. Because one of my most humbling moments came when I was doing the communion meditation at First Christian Church in Decatur, Georgia. A lot of my friends were out there. I was in my 20s. Parents and people I'd known from the church growing up. And Fred Craddock was there that Sunday. Fred Craddock was like the preacher in the Disciples. And he was a member of First Christian Church in Decatur, Georgia, where I had grown up and was a member. He was there in the Atlanta area because he was on the staff of Candler School of Theology connected with Emory University. He was their professor of New Testament and homiletics, preaching professor. And so people flocked from all over the country to go to Emory, to Candler School of Theology, to hear him. So he's out there. And I'm giving it, and I didn't have a note in front of me because I've tried to do these things from memory, and my mind just disappeared. It went to Mars, and I was clueless. And I'm thinking, what in the world am I going to do? So ever since that moment, I have had something written out, at least for the major things. I'll come back to that later. So, speaking of being humbled, Israel had been humbled a lot. Judah had been humbled a lot throughout their history. And the prophets kept reminding the people about the need to be faithful and that they would be restored. They would be brought back because they were chosen by God. Remember your place. You are chosen to be a light to the world. And prophet after prophet would pronounce that there would be a restoration, forgiveness, wholeness. And one would come who would bring them back and restore them as the people of God. Foretold, a Messiah, a Savior, the promised one, the chosen one, whatever term you want to mention. Prophet after prophet after prophet. So that takes us to Bethlehem. And Micah is one of those prophets. And he says, "But you, Bethlehem Ephratah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times." So one of the classified minor prophets mentions this about Bethlehem. Bethlehem was about 8 miles from Jerusalem. So that's like having a foothill next to a mighty mountain. The opportunities, the wealth, the trade that flowed through Bethlehem were nothing compared to Jerusalem. But here is this reference that from Bethlehem is going to come this mighty, mighty ruler. How could that be? What was special about Bethlehem? Well, Bethlehem was also the city of David. David, the example extraordinaire of a ruler of Israel. When people thought of the epitome of a ruler of Israel, it was David. And David was from Jerusalem, or from Bethlehem. And David had this image of what this church, or what this king, ruler should be like. And so when the people thought of this ruler, they thought in terms of David. They thought of mighty and powerful. And so the ones who remembered this scripture kind of already had a focus and an idea of what the ruler would be like. This promised ruler who would restore Israel would be like David. Not some little obscure baby born in some backward town. The people had these expectations that God would act in this way, that God would restore them. And they had this image of what it would look like and who it would be and what that person would be like and where that person would come from and what that person would experience and how that person would be with the people and what people that mighty one would be with. And they had it all laid out in their hopes and dreams and imaginings when they thought about this coming promised one. But God had other ideas. So when we get to this Christmas season, there are a lot of expectations, especially if you are a child, have young children around you in any way. Try teaching 21 first graders this time of year. The expectations, what it's about, it gets sidetracked. Despite our best efforts to rein it in, it goes to Santa Claus. Now, this is from Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the special that came out in the 60s. And back then, it showed once, maybe twice, if the networks were in a good Christmassy mood. But if you didn't see it, that time that it showed, you missed it. Because there weren't all those networks and DVDs and DVRs and all this and video cassette players. None of that. So you had one chance to get it. And so I grew up and this is what Santa Claus looked like. And this Santa Claus image that we have of dressed in red and black boots and black belt. Well, you know what that means? That means that Santa Claus is a Georgia fan. Red, black. So I'm watching this year after year after year. And let's face it, Santa and Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer is a jerk. When he first encounters Rudolph, he is startled by the nose and tells him, "You can't be a reindeer, not with that nose. You're thrown out. You're outcast, Rudolph. You're unwanted." And part of me was going, "How can Santa act like that?" And Santa also has his fair share of grumpiness. He snaps at the elves. It's not good enough. He's just kind of sour through a lot of the show. But the moment that is the worst, and the one I struggled with the most when I began to kind of understand, was when Santa comes out because the snowstorm has been unending, and they doesn't see a way that he can safely take the reindeer and the sleigh on his rounds going around the world because it is so bad that he comes out and announces that Christmas is canceled. And I remember watching that and I gasped, is Christmas canceled? And of course, that's the setup for Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer and his shining nose just blasts through the worst the storms can offer, and Santa saves the day. You know the song. Won't you guide my sleigh tonight? And so it's great for telling the story of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. But is Christmas canceled? Can Santa do that? Christmas is canceled. And then I started standing up when we'd get to these moments in Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, and I would shout, no, Santa, it is not canceled. You are not what Christmas is all about. It was my way of kind of striking back. No, you don't get to do that. You do not get to cancel Christmas. Because Christmas means so much more. And as you grow as a child, that begins to sink in. But it's a trap that adults, no matter what age we are, can also fall into. And all of the busyness of the season, the meaning can get outcast, shoved to the side. And sometimes it gets difficult to find that joy and that hope and that love that is what the season is all about. Mary reminds us of what the season is all about. She says, the lowly will be raised up. And the rich will be turned empty away. Now, that is not a blanket statement about riches, wealth, but it is a statement about the attitude of how we approach things. For sometimes when we're well off, we think we've got it all under control. And the lowly, what is it about the lowly? What is it about Bethlehem, this humble, kind of woebegone, forgotten little town that would give birth to the one who is ruler over all? It's a clue. It's a clue to the divine mystery that God would choose lowly Bethlehem and not mighty Jerusalem. That God would choose a humble maiden from a small town, Nazareth something. And from lowly, forgotten, kind of discounted people would come the one who would be ruler over all. It's a clue that God is about to upend the way a lot of people see the world. And all those people who had this picture of mighty David returning and who he would be with and what he would do, well, they go on to continue to be mostly blind, we know, throughout Jesus' life. But God has been dropping clues for centuries through the prophets. This is what I am about. Another one of those prophets Again, God, one of those pesky minor prophets that has something to say that doesn't go on and on like Ezekiel and Isaiah, some of the better known ones. No. This is from Zephaniah. The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. The sorrows for the appointed feasts I will remove from you. At that time I will deal with all who oppressed you. I will rescue the lame and gather the outcast. I will give them praise and honor in every land where they were put to shame. The clues are there. That what people count as success and making it in the world are not necessarily God's ways. And the people are reminded again and again to have the heart of God, not the heart of the world. See the world, people of God, through God's eyes, not as the world sees it. Jesus would go on to say, "Peace I give to you, not as the world gives." God is giving clues throughout the prophets. In the scripture from Luke today about Mary saying that here is the one who is promised and will bring salvation, and I am humbled to be a part of it. How are you a part of it? When I was looking at things for this sermon, I had this figure that I'd been given many, many years ago. And it is this Santa kneeling in front of the cradle. So what are the origins of Santa? Saint Nicholas was a bishop in the early church in the 4th century in the part of the world, small part called part of Turkey now. So somewhere in what is now Turkey is where this Christian monk was well known, became a bishop, and was known for his kindness and his generosity. There are all kinds of stories that are out there, but one of the ones that most people refer to is that he apparently helped a Christian father have a dowry for his 3 daughters. And there are even stories about he climbed up on the roof and dropped bags of gold down through the chimney. And there are all kinds of things that you can go and find. But we do know that there was a Christian named Nicholas who became a saint in the church, and his special day is December 6th. Sometime gifts were given as part of remembering Saint Nicholas and his kindness and his generosity, especially to children. He's the patron saint of children. And so on his feast day, gifts would be given. Well, in England, when the Church of England take over and the Catholic Church was pushed to the side, they moved this gift-giving tradition from St. Nicholas' feast day, December 6th, to Christmas Day, to December 25th. And so as both English settlers and Dutch settlers came over, merged in our American culture to give us Santa Claus, because the Dutch called him Sinterklaas. And so that became Santa Claus. And it grew and it flourished along with Clement Moore, who wrote a very famous poem. Now, here's a question that if you ever get it right on Jeopardy and win a boatload of money, half of it comes back to Cool Water. So what was the original name for what we know as 'Twas the Night Before Christmas? Do, 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 do. A visit from St. Nicholas. And why we call it 'Twas the Night Before Christmas is, that's the first line. But he kind of helped create this image, and then other artists created this image that we know. So I had this Santa, and I Googled it, and I Googled Santa with Jesus, and this is one of the images that came up, of Santa kneeling before the cradle. And it puts it in perspective for those of us who follow Jesus. Jesus, we know, is the reason for the season, as the saying goes. We know that. We know that. We know it's not about Santa Claus. We know that that Santa part and that gift-giving part is fun. It's joyful. But the image of this Santa is one that in its best way is that he is an ambassador of the season of love and joy, of giving, that generosity in our heart. So if you think about Santa Claus, then go back to the origins. A believer in Christ who gave because he had a kind and generous heart, who wanted to reach out and touch the lives of people around him. A man who was known for his kindness and compassion for the poor and for the children and the lowly. Remind you of anybody you've heard of? Like Mary and Joseph and the shepherds? Clues scattered throughout history that God's reign is coming, has come, and is in the world. And so really the question is, how will we be a part of it? What image of Christmas will we present? Will we be like those who have it all figured out and have God's moves for our future all envisioned and where everything is going? Because we know how it's all supposed to play out. And where we are in life, we see the map. And when we do that, we become like the rich who are turned away empty because there's no room left for surprise. There's no room left for the mystery. There's no room left for the wonder. And in that mystery and that wonder and that surprise, we can find the real gift of Christmas. That God has a purpose, and we are part of it, and God is asking you to join Him in touching the world in the name of Jesus and shining this light of Christmas every day in the best way of Saint Nicholas, with love and kindness and generosity to those who are outcast and poor, to those who need a helping hand, to those who need a friendly face and a friendly voice, to those we can touch around us. So in your preparations, don't have it so all figured out. In your living of your life, don't have it so all figured out that you shut the door on how God is looking to bring surprise and joy and